we're going to do double duty. So thanks for everybody for tolerating me again today. I think Dr. Small lost sight of where he is in the room, but he's gonna back me up on some of the discussion on systemic therapy. So he'll bring up the tail end of this. All right. Well, actually commented to Dr. Small that it sounds like Dr. Hope actually did part of my job today. So, all right. Well, I thought I'd leave off with sort of a leading part, which is, you know, what is oligometastatic cancer? This hypothesis was sort of proposed by a couple of folks at the University of Chicago ways back now. And the idea is that there's this intermediate state of cancer spread between localized disease and widespread metastases. And to a certain extent, I think that this feels pretty, you know, like pretty rational that situations where there's been metastatic spread are not all created equally. Traditionally, I think largely due to the limitations in our science, this has been defined primarily by imaging findings. And so a lot of trials use sort of the number of metastases as part of their definition. And traditionally we've used somewhere in the range of 1 to 5. But you know, biology is also important. There have been more studies looking at biology that I won't talk about too much today. This sort of pattern and spectrum of progression is important to consider. And so the corollary of this is that if there is this so-called oligometastatic state, there are a subset of folks with metastatic cancer that could be potentially cured. And so that was kind of the sort of premise that was laid out at that point. And this was a thought that was considered across all different types of cancers. There have been a number of sort of other definitions that have built upon that. There's sort of this idea of synchronous oligometastatic disease, which is when there are limited metastases at the time of initial diagnosis, and then the so-called metachronous oligorecurrence, which happens after the primary treatments occurred. And most of our data across oligometastatic cancer and certainly in prostate cancer is more in this metachronous situation where folks have recurrence and we're able to identify these limited lesions. And of course, the session is about PSA recurrence. So I talked a little bit about SBRT earlier, it's been alluded to a few times in the subsequent talks. But SBRT is, again, high doses of radiation that are delivered in few treatments with image guidance. It's used in a number of primary cancers, but it's also used in oligometastases for very focused directed therapies. So in the past, as this hypothesis was forming across all cancers, there were a few trials that were conducted at the University of Chicago and subsequently at other institutions to look at the potential benefit of and potential control of treatment of oligometastases with short courses of radiation. And I had the privilege of working with some of these folks in pooling sort of the three kind of early phase trials. And one of the things that sticks out when you go through the data and analyze it statistically, that there are certain types of features and characteristics across patients that at least can be some proxy for understanding where patients rest in this so-called oligometastatic space. And among them is having prostate cancer, which tends to be more amenable to these oligometastatic strategies. And certainly in the years subsequent, Dr. Hope, I think, mentioned the STOMP trial, but there have been a number of other trials in the prostate cancer space looking at what we call metastasis-directed therapy or SBRT to these lesions. There's also one study, SABRE-COMET, which was a study looking across all cancers at oligometastases. But you'll notice that they're kind of going back to Dr. Small's discussion earlier about randomized trials. These are all sort of smaller randomized phase 2 trials. I thought I'd just like pick one of them in the interest of time, but this is one of the more recent ones. JAMA network of journals have some like nice figures to present clinical trials and to give a punchline. This is a slide from the EXTEND trial. This is across the trials, the one that incorporates hormone therapy into the treatment paradigm of metastasis-directed therapy. The STOMP and ORIOL trials used SBRT as a means to delay hormone therapy. In the EXTEND trial, patients were actually given a short course of hormone therapy, and then the data was analyzed also in consideration of testosterone recovery and when folks had recovered from that. And you can see that, basically patients were randomized to hormone therapy alone or with or without metastasis-directed SBRT. And the summary and punchline here is similar to those studies that were done without hormone therapy, which is that SBRT can extend progression-free survival. And so this has been kind of shown in these earlier phase studies across these different settings. I thought I'd include this slide, which is a figure from Saber Comet. Again, Saber Comet was designed across all cancers, but they did have a quality of life component in the study. And so one of the things that they did was provide a general quality of life questionnaire for all patients in their control group, in those patients who received metastasis-directed SBRT. And they found no difference in quality of life. And sort of the like overall piece here is that the SBRT largely can be delivered in most scenarios with sort of precision and sort of limited impacts in quality of life. That of course varies from situation, but sort of in summary. And so most of those trials were done in the pre-PSMA PET era. And so as Dr. Hope alluded to, imaging is getting better and we're able to detect metastases at a greater sensitivity. And so this has sort of resulted in a lot of changes in, both like how early we're able to pick up disease, but also in how we should be, thinking about the data from preceding clinical trials. One of the SBRT MD metastasis-directed therapy trials was the ORIOL trial. And one of the components of this study was, even though it wasn't part of the clinical management, patients did get PSMA PETs. And so even though their sort of general treatment plan and approach was done without the PSMA PET, one of the things they were able to look at was whether or not patients had all of their PSMA PET detected lesions treated. And you can see that there's a split there where 19 of the patients had a total treatment of all PSMA PET lesions, which were also identified on conventional imaging, versus 16 patients that didn't have all the PSMA PET lesions treated. And one of the sort of hypothesis generating pieces of this study, which also feels fairly rational, is that those patients who had all of their lesions treated had superior outcomes compared to those patients who had lesions that weren't treated. So with that, I will pass it over to Dr. Small to talk about hormone therapy and systemic therapy.
Thanks, Julian. I'm going to just take a sec to finish this off. Dr. Hong mentioned the EXTEND trial in which adding SBRT, adding radiation to hormones was better than hormones alone. That was good. It establishes the principle that targeting local therapy is important. But the converse question is the one that we're often faced with, which is there's a couple spots or five spots or one spot. Does adding hormones to the radiation make a difference? And the honest answer to that question is we don't know, and that we are left with extrapolation. The reason for that is, as you've just heard from Dr. Hope, we had PSMA PET here early, but even at UCSF, we've had PSMA PET for 6 years, 7 years, something like that. It was FDA approved 4 years ago, less than 4 years ago. It takes 10, 15, 20 years to complete a clinical trial, and certainly an earlier stage prostate cancer. And so most of the data that we have, most, not all, but most of the randomized data that we have is from the pre-PSMA PET era. Some of the trials that Julian alluded to, STOMP, ORIOL, and so forth, are exceptions, but they're small, and we're still waiting for those really mature trials. NRG, the successor to RTOG, is conducting, you know, one of the sentinel trials of adding hormones to SBRT, but it's underway. You know, we don't have the answers. So consequently, you know, when you see a couple spots and we've decided it's completely logical to do targeted radiation therapy if there's a few spots. And we do it all the time. But we're forced to sort of extrapolate from other clinical trials undertaken in the pre-PSMA era to define the type and duration of hormonal therapy. Dr. Roach already alluded to the issue of, again, in the pre-PSMA PET era, we've got lots of experience from work in the radiation oncology field about the optimal duration of hormones depending on the risk of the cancer. And by and large, the higher the risk, the more hormones you need. It's sort of the simple way of doing it. So there's a lot of features that go into our thinking about it. For sure, sort of conventional stuff like PSA, Gleason score stage, prior to even identifying these spots, more recently Decipher score, potentially in the future, things like the Artera AI approach, as well as the current characteristics of the cancer. So it's very different if we see a solitary lymph node in the pelvis compared to 5 metastases in bone or in liver, right? It's sort of intuitive. And there's a whole spectrum in between. So this is sort of, I tried to put this together as to give you an insight into the discussions when a patient sees one of our radiation oncologists or urologists, and they're sent to us with questions about, you know, what kind of hormone therapy. These are the considerations that we have. So I'm looking at sort of from low risk to high risk patients. On the PET scan, I alluded to this, if you have a single pelvic lymph node, that's very different than if you have a lot of bone lesions. Characteristics of the cancer at diagnosis, you can see that if you're organ confined or beyond the organ into the lymph nodes in the bone, it changes your Decipher score and your PSA. By the way, whether you say PSA is 20 or 30 or 4 or 1, sort of immaterial, right? It's a spectrum, and it's what we take into account. And then the current cancer characteristics, the lower the PSA, the likely the less cancer is present, likely the less we worry about extensive disease. If we see someone with oligometastatic disease who has a PSA of 30 or 40 or 50, we're worried that there may be something that we're missing. And finally, the PSA doubling time, which has not been looked at really carefully prospectively, but the PSA doubling time is not something you eyeball, it's something you calculate. But if it's moving really quickly and your PSA is doubling every month, that tells you that there's cancer out there. If it's moving very slowly and it's taking 24 months to double, then you're a little more comfortable that what you're seeing on the PSMA scan is what it's going to be for a while, at least. The thing about PSMA PET scan, and Tom Hope alluded to this, is that it's much better than anything we have, but it's not perfect. And so we may always miss some things. And so the higher the risk characteristics of the patient, the more likely we are to have missed something that you just can't see yet, and that will pop up along the way. So I've already alluded to the PET scan findings. And then the type and duration of hormonal therapy, which is sort of the discussion that we have, is, you know, if this is a solitary lymph node and, you know, the patient wants to avoid hormonal therapy, it's probably okay to do so. If it's a number of lymph nodes in the pelvis, in the pre-PSMA PET era, we've got reasonably compelling evidence that 6 months of androgen deprivation therapy just with the treatment of the testicular androgen is sufficient. And in the pre-PSMA PET era, in a imperfect study, we have evidence, Dr. Hong already alluded to, you know, the duration is anywhere from 18 to 36 months. So, but we have a study that suggests that 24 months of intensified ADT, which we talked about already, the combination of the two agents, is what's appropriate. It's an extrapolation. because in that study, there was radiation to the prostate only. It wasn't SBRT. It's not in the salvage setting. So it's all extrapolation. And we acknowledge that, but we try to make the best approximation for the individual patient. The goals of therapy are really important as we make these decisions. If someone wants to avoid systemic therapy, then we do that. We can delay the time until next therapy. That's what the initial studies that Julian spoke to and that Tom spoke to, which kicks the can down the road, which is we're going to radiate now. We know something will pop up later, but at least it delays stuff. And we hope to eliminate the risk of recurrence, which is a cure. And Dr. Roach gave an example of someone who he found a spot, radiated, and was cured. As we measure the outcomes in an individual patient, the challenge is that if we give hormonal therapy, the PSA is going to fall to undetectable. And so you really have to wait until you complete the radiation and you complete the full length of the hormone therapy, whether it's 6 months or 24 months, and wait for the testosterone levels to recover, and then track the PSA. And that's okay. We have experience here at UCSF, and Julian is involved in some of these data, Mac and Peter as well, where we do repetitive PSMA PET scans. And it's really pretty remarkable. It's changed how we approach this disease, meaning PSA climbs, we find a spot on PSMA PET scan, we radiate that spot, the PSA falls, we track the PSA over time, the PSA goes up, we do it again, PSA falls, we track it. I'm curious to hear from you guys, but in my personal record is someone who's undergone that process 7 times. And we have a series of folks who've done, 2 or 3 times. There's probably 30 or 40 in our database. So pretty remarkable. And it's really changed the tone of this. I hate to ever confess that Mac was right and I was wrong, but Mac was right many, many years ago when he, really focused on, if you radiate the lymph nodes, if you go after lymph nodes, this can absolutely delay therapy or cure. I used to say, and this proof that you can teach an old dog new tricks. I used to say, oh, by the time it's in the lymph nodes, it's systemic. There's nothing you can do about it. This kind of approach has revolutionized the way we do it. And it's really, really quite exciting. I think that's all I had.